play a game?
Why, yes. I believe we shall.
Oh, I got a live one here.
Live from Little Rock, it's Shane Plays Radio, Geek Talk Radio, a journey into the things we love. I'm your host, Shane Stacks. Thanks so much for joining me, whether you're listening live over the air on 96.5 FM, The Answer, in the Central Arkansas area, or if you're listening online at 96.5FMTheAnswer.com, or if you're listening delayed by podcast or on Krypton Radio, I'm just really glad you're here. We got a really cool and unique show today. Not only do I have two sponsors, full disclosure, I have two sponsors in the room, but we're going to be talking about something very cool that they've come together to do involving Edgar Rice Burroughs, who, of course, is Tarzan, Jon Carter of Mars, and one of the main people of the pulp era, that we wouldn't have half of the geeky stuff we have now if we didn't have the pulp era. So we'll be talking about that later today in the show, or we're actually here pretty soon, and I'll introduce my guests here in a moment. Now, remember, this is Live Geek Talk Radio. If you happen to be listening to the live version, it's 501-823-0965. That's 501-823-0965. Or you can tweet me at Shane Plays. That's S-H-A-N-E-P-L-A-Y-S. And I have received tweets during the live show from as far away as Argentina. So I know that people listen and tweet during the live show via the stream. So speaking of Shane Plays, the show notes and the links for today's show are on ShanePlays.com right now, including if you go to Shane Plays, you can find last week's show where I was live from the Little Rock Comic Con, had a great show, talked about Star Trek, Star Trek Discovery, had actor Santiago Cirillo. Zach, Santiago Cirillo, was that dude not a maniac? I loved him.
I love him too.
That guy was great. I'm going to give him a full show. He does veterans work too on top of being an actor, so I'm definitely gonna have him on. He was off the hook. So, and I can I say, am I cool enough to say off the hook? Is that even a cool thing to say anymore? Off the chain, off the hook? I don't know. Steve's already over there laughing. Is that even cool to say anymore, Steve?
I have no idea.
That's Stephen Chenault of Chenault and Gray Publishing and Troll Lord Games, sponsor for Castles and Crusades and their other stuff here on the show. You're here today under the auspices of Chenault and Gray Publishing.
Officially I'm with the parent company today.
Company of Chenault and Gray. We'll talk about that here in a second. We got Michael Tierney.
Hi, how you doing?
Hey, come on in. Get up on that mic a little bit, Mike.
Hi.
Wow, I wasn't even trying to make a pun there. So, anyway, glad to have you back on the show. Of course, you're a sponsor, Collector's Edition, the Wild Stars comic book store. You've been on the show before. We've just talked about the Wild Stars and other cool comic book stuff. You're a contributor to the Comic Book Buyer's Guide. You've written articles throughout the years. You're a self-publisher of you know your comic books.
Oh, yeah.
But today we're talking about your work on Edgar Rice Burroughs.
Right.
And a very exciting Kickstarter that both of y'all have come together on. So we'll be talking about that today. Folks, don't forget that the show does go out. In addition, I love talk radio. I love it so much. I did 4 hours yesterday for Dave Ellswick while he was out. I did a Memorial Day show. I love talk radio, but I also love podcasts. So the show does go out as a podcast on the blog at ShanePlays.com, iTunes, Google Play Music, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, and other fine podcast directories. And also, if you subscribe to my YouTube channel, which I just exceeded 1,000 subscribers, which I guess is a big deal because YouTube emailed me about that and said, congratulations,
cool,
you're in this 1,000 subscriber. I'll tell you what's funny, Steve. I mainly work the show. I love doing my Shane Plays Geek Talk Radio show, but I also do some YouTube stuff just on the side, and I do D&D videos and RPG videos and, you know, anything. Like, we've talked before about doing videos on here's how to do a ranger, here's how to do that. So just RPG stuff in general. So I'm sitting there working the show last week at Little Rock Comic. Shane, I'm on, got the microphone, and the dude's like, D&D YouTube pointing at me. So, yeah, I guess the YouTube is starting to catch on
a little bit.
Yeah,
people love those videos.
Yeah, they do.
You've been talking about that for a while.
I'll tell you what I do. One of the main things I do is I run a weekly game, and then I put notes up on YouTube. Here's what happened to the game. And people are like, I love this. This helps me get ready to play, and I go over rules discussions and stuff like that. So, and I told you we're going to do some Castles of Crusades and stuff up on Roll 20.
Oh, good deal.
That's going to be fun.
That'll be a blast.
Yeah, that'll be a blast. So, okay, anyway, We're also, Shane Plays is also carried on Krypton Radio. Krypton Radio is sci-fi for your Wi-Fi, kryptonradio.com. We are played a week delayed on Krypton Radio on Saturdays and Mondays. Okay, so I've introduced Michael Tierney, author, historian, knows more about comic book, or has forgotten more about comic books than I'll ever know. And then, of course, we've got Steve Chenault from Chenault and Gray / Trollord Games in the house. We're going to be talking about Edgar Rice Burroughs. And you guys have a Kickstarter that has really kind of blown up a little bit.
It's done well.
Not only did it come within a pretty large percentage of its goal on day one,
yeah,
but Kickstarter picked it as a project we love.
Yeah, that was really cool.
That is cool. So we're going to talk about that for the majority of the show. But first, we do have the news. So, Zach, turn on the super secret microphone in the newsroom. Working on Saturday. Wow. That's a loyal news crew right there. Folks, don't forget, for every dollar of support that the Patreon gets for Shane Plays, the news team gets a penny an hour raise. For every dollar we get on Patreon, they get a penny an hour raise. It's a win-win for everybody. All right, so my first news item here, and Mike, I definitely want your input on this.
Okay.
So I guess earlier this week, Rich Buckler, the co-creator of Deathlok and also the creator of All-Star Squadron, passed away at age 68. Were you aware of that?
Yes, I was. Yeah.
Yeah. Did you ever meet him in any of your...
No, I've never met Rich.
Yeah. Well, I guess he's mainly known for Deathlok, but I love Deathlok, but in the 80s, I love the All-Star Squadron. I thought that was a very cool team. Yeah.
He co-created that with Roy Thomas.
Right. So,
now where he really broke into the industry was he was the guy who replaced Jack Kirby when Jack Kirby left Fantastic Four.
I did not know that.
He did like 100 issue run, and then Richard Buckler was his replacement, and he was trying to draw in his style, and he did a pretty good job.
Well, here's another thing he did that is huge that I didn't want to wear. He worked with Peter David on the death of Gene DeWolf in Spider-Man. That was a really big story in the 80s for Spider-Man, where one of the detectives that the Spider-Man worked with got killed.
Right, so that was back when the death card was an unusual. They hadn't killed many people in comics.
Yeah, it didn't happen a lot. Right,
so that was a big deal back then. Now it's pretty common.
Yeah. Well, now Steve, I know you got geek cred in many areas. Were you any of these comics for you?
I collected comics, and actually it's one of the few collector passions I have, but it's almost predominantly DC, and it was Tarzan, interestingly enough. I love
right.
the old
oh, yeah, strangely
the,
enough.
The Tarzan yeah. comics, huge fan of the 24-issue Marvel series. I loved that one. But I was a Green Lantern guy. I bought just about anything Green Lantern.
Yeah, so I've always been a big Green Lantern guy. So anyway,
which is probably
why
I like Neil Adams so much, because didn't he do a lot of covers from...
Oh, yeah.
Neil Adams.
He had a great run on Green Lantern.
Yeah.
It was Neil Green Adams Lantern, Green Arrow.
Yeah, yeah. That's when I picked the first one up at like a Piggly Wiggly issue number 92 or
Piggly
95.
Wiggly.
Was it the one where Green Arrow was shooting the lantern and breaking the lantern?
I could see
that's
the,
a classic
no,
cover.
No, it's like Washington, D.C. in the background or something. Is that
the one where he's shooting the lantern with Arrow? That was the first one that started Neil Adams' run.
Oh, was it? That's a classic cover.
And they did a lot of different... They touched on religion. They touched on drug use.
Well, they
it was
did
a
that
controversial
sort of
series.
Travel across America because... Yeah. Green Arrow was basically the liberal, and Hal Jordan, Green Lantern, was more of the conservative, and so they looked at America through two different viewpoints,
right?
Which was very unique for back then.
Way ahead of its
time. Yeah, ahead of its time. So anyway,
that's I'm just way ahead of my time. That's
totally what it is. Dude. Yeah. So, but anyway, he also worked with on Superman versus Shazam with Jerry Conway. And then he also, this is an interesting piece of trivia. Buckner first gave George Perez a job in the 70s as studio assistant.
Oh, wow. That's wild. Yeah. George Perez at one time used to be considered to be the worst artist in the Marvel universe.
Who was?
George Perez.
You're kidding.
Yeah. And but he came a long way.
He's great. You know, he just had a heart attack.
I did not know
that. Yeah, I don't know the full details, but I know he's canceled all of his con appearances for the time being because of a heart attack. I'm not sure of the details, but
his Wonder Woman series was fantastic.
Amazing. Oh, everything that I've ever seen. He did Crisis on Infinite Earths.
That was very important work. Yeah.
Teen Titans.
Yeah. They did the best Teen Titans they've ever done.
Yeah. So anyway, but of course we wish George well. So that's comic book artist Rich Buckler passed away earlier this week after battling cancer. And then Also, we've lost Roger Moore. Sir Roger Moore earlier this week. Oh, and that last news article people can find linked, and that's from comicbook.com. They can find that on the show notes at shaneplays.com. And, of course, Roger Moore, legendary James Bond actor, has passed away. And I, you know, I love James Bond in general. Roger Moore was basically, I was born in 72. So when I was growing, he was basically my James Bond, you know. And you know, I was thinking earlier today, I was like, what is, if I had to pick what I think the quintessential Roger Moore, James, Bond movie is, Moonraker's a lot of fun. Moonraker's kind of a gonzo bonkers, lot of fun Bond movie. Cause Star Wars is so successful. Right. They said, we got to get James Bond up into space. But, For Your Eyes Only is my favorite. That is the quintessential Roger Moore, James Bond movie for me, because it had that nice mix of, this is a very serious plot, but of course he's being James Bond and, you know, the women and, you know, it had some humor in it and all that. So that's just my quintessential.
I'm there with you. When you say James Bond, I think Roger Moore.
Yeah.
And he's got that same thing that Harrison Ford does as Indiana Jones. He's got that smile, kind of smirk to it.
Yeah.
You know, there's a little bit of humor behind everything he's doing, which I always appreciate. It's cool stuff.
So anyway, I hope James Bond, you know, it continues to be a strong franchise. I've thought since they've redone it, starting at Casino Royale with, I can't believe I'm blanking on the name. But they've gone more into the roots of how Ian Fleming wrote James Bond, you know.
Yeah.
But anyway, good stuff. So I don't know if either of you guys have a favorite Bond, Roger Moore, James Bond movie or not, but
I'm a Sean Connery fan.
Yeah, well, I love Sean Connery. I like all the Bonds on some level, you know. But
most people don't realize Woody Allen once played James Bond.
Yeah, and there was a spoof Casino Royale.
That's a horrible thought.
Well, no, it's actually a funny movie.
David Niven,
There's a it's called Casino Royale, and there's like 8 different James Bonds in it, and Woody Allen is one of them.
Yeah, he's so, Jimmy Bond.
Yeah,
and the only other time they ever used the name Jimmy Bond is when they did Casino Royale as a Masterpiece Theater type of show on television where they filmed it live. I think it was Barry Nelson was the first James Bond.
Yeah,
and then at the end they called him Jimmy too.
Okay, see, I didn't...
The two Jimmys.
I didn't even know.
Okay, I got to track this down.
So. Yeah. But anyway, Roger Moore's gone, so we've lost Rich Buckler from the comics world. We've lost Roger Moore. And also, let's not forget The Saint, where he played Simon Templar, where he was kind of a Robin Hood kind of criminal, and that gained him...
Yeah.
I'm sure everybody was like, this guy's got to play James Bond, because it was kind of a similar character.
Yeah, he'd foil the criminals and then take all their money.
Yeah, and take all their money, so... So we'll miss Roger Moore. And of course he's done work with with United Nations and UNICEF and all that. And he also played, I'd forgotten about this. This article's from CBR.com linked on the show notes. He played in the Cannonball Run. Roger Moore was in the Cannonball Run playing a millionaire who is obsessed with James Bond, who had plastic surgery to make him look like Roger Moore.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So, I forgot that.
Yeah. That was a lot of fun. So, and then, you know, lately he did movies, Agent Crush, Cats and Dogs, The Revenge of Kitty Galore, just kind of having some fun. Let's see what his other recent work was. The Saint TV movie and Troll Hunters. So anyway, that we're going to miss both them. What even though moments of silence and radio are supposed to be a no-no, I do them when the moment requires. So we're going to have a moment of silence for Roger Moore and Rich Buckler. And that moment of silence was for comics artist Rich Buckler, who passed away this week from cancer, and Roger Moore, of course, mainly known for his role as James Bond. So, all right, guys, that's the news. I did a short news segment. I got one other thing to mention. We almost had a rupture in the space-time continuum on Thursday. Do you know why?
I do not.
Because not only was it the 40th anniversary of Star Wars premiering in theaters, Star Wars premiered on May 25th, 1977. At a very small number of theaters. They didn't know if it was going to be a hit or not. And I think George Lucas was actually thinking he might have a bomb on his hand.
I think he left the country.
Left the country, yeah. And I think, not Spielberg. Who's the other big? I think Scorsese or somebody like that, or Francis Ford Coppola called him and said, you're doing great. You know, your movie's doing great, because he was hiding. So anyway, so that was May 25th, 1977. And then also, it just so happened that May 25th, 2017, this year, was Towel Day from Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. That's where they honor and remember Douglas Adams. So on the same day, we almost had a rupture in the space-time continuum. And of course, in the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, you always kept a towel with you. And if you were somebody who people respected, they would say that guy really knows where his towel is at. So did either of you ever read Hitchhikers?
I have not.
Oh, I did years.
Love Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. That guy really knows where his towel is at.
That's where the number 42
is. Yeah, the number 42 is the answer to life. Yeah, they built a mega computer. Yeah,
I've seen the movie.
Yeah, to say, what's the answer to life, universe, and everything? And 100 years later, it spits out 42. And they're like, well, what's the question? Well, now we got to build another computer to figure out what the question is. So, okay, anyway, moving on. I did a short news segment so that we could really talk about not only the Kickstarter. We want to promote the Kickstarter. 100 years, Edgar Rice Burroughs, 100-year art chronology. Now, Mike, every time I've gone into your store for like the past 2 years, you've been working on this thing. This is a passion project for you.
Yeah, who needs sleep?
Yeah, who needs sleep? So Edgar Rice Burroughs, of course, although he did other things, he mainly did the main things he's known for, Tarzan and Jon Carter of Mars.
Right.
Okay. And I would argue that Tarzan has gotten more into the popular conscience.
Oh, he's an international icon.
Right.
Yeah.
But there's still a lot of people out there that love, and the whole Jon Carter of Mars Barsoom stuff had a whole lot of imitators and pulp.
Avatar imitator.
There you go. So exactly. So we got a couple of minutes before the break. And what's happening is Michael has worked on this passion project, collected all this artwork together from all these novels and comics and pulp books and just all this stuff of Edgar Rice Burroughs' work, and you've restored it to where it looks amazing.
Right, yeah. Some of those old pulp images, I literally put 40-hour work weeks into just one image to make it look like it's brand new.
To make them get pristine. And you've been working in conjunction with the Edgar Rice Burroughs Foundation. Is that the name of it?
Yeah, Edgar Rice Burroughs Incorporated.
So they know what's going on. You've been in close touch with them.
Oh, yeah.
This has their blessing.
Yeah, well, you have to because they own the rights. So.
So, and then Steve... Chenault and Gray Publishing, Trollord Games, y'all have come together. You've done the books, and Steve, you're publishing.
Yes.
Okay. And you've done a Kickstarter because you've found tremendous success over the past few years.
We've done well with Kickstarter.
With Kickstarters is a great way to, not only promote, but also to, to do the business side of it.
It's the promotion side is huge because Kickstarter's become such a platform where people go just to see what's being made, see what's going on, especially in the pop culture universe, whether it's comics or whatever it is.
So it's not just a sales venue, it's also an advertising venue.
Right.
Yeah, it's huge. I I'm not saying this applies to Troller Games or Chenault and Gray Publishing, but I do know of people who they don't need the money from the Kickstarter. They kickstart because they want the promotion.
Right. That's about half of the reason we use Kickstarter. I mean, we've been in business for 19 years, so we publish books all the time. But Kickstarter's become a great venue to actually promote because it's what we call, on the game side of it, we call alpha gamers. They're the people who go out and they're going to spend money for stuff. They don't want to wait for it to come out and look at it. They want to see what's going on, and they love it. I mean, they're gamers to the core. And because you'll see some of these guys with 400 projects they've backed. It's mind-boggling.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And, I don't know where they get the money, but God bless them. I can't support 400 Kickstarters, I'll tell you that.
Well, you have a hobby that it's passionate about. I mean, you look at my comics collection. I've got almost all the Silver Age Green Lantern and Green Arrow, and I don't know how much that's worth, but it's
probably a lot of money.
Yeah, I've sunk some money into it. Now, if you were to, ask me to tally it all up, I would be... horrified, but I'm not going to do that. So.
Right, but it's a passion for you.
It's a passion, yeah.
Right. So at a certain point, the money falls away, and it's passion. Right, I get that. So y'all have come together, and it just so happens, again, in full disclosure, you're both sponsors of the show. Thank you. This weekend is actually basically the two-year anniversary of Shane Plays.
Oh, congratulations. Congratulations.
We went May 30th, 2015, and Michael, you've been with me since the beginning.
Right.
And you came on pretty early, Steve. So both of you, thank you for being sponsors. So just full disclosure, you are sponsors, but I'd have you on the show anyway for this because this is a great project. And I've never had an Edgar Rice Burroughs show. So, and with the impact that Edgar Rice Burroughs, especially Tarzan, but also Jon Carter of Mars has had on pop culture and in turn, basically the geek world. Mm-hmm. This is a fantastic topic. So what I want to do, we're going to get a break in. When we come back, I want to talk about, you know, why we'll talk. We will talk about the Kickstarter of the show, what people can get, what's involved. But I want to talk about when we come back from the break, why is Tarzan so important? Why is Jon Carter so important? Why was the pulp era important, not just for literature, but also for the art, all the amazing art that came out of the pulp era. So I want to talk about that when we come back for a break.
All that is addressed in the books,
too. Yeah. And the books are great. It's 4-volume books that they're worth the price of admission just for all the art you've restored.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Volumes, they're a monster of volumes because they're 10 by 15.
Yeah.
And on top of that, it's over 1,200 pages.
Yeah.
140,000 words and over 5,000 images.
Well, I'll tell you, I'm glad that you've aligned yourself with Chenault and Gray because they've allowed you to move forward with your original vision.
Right.
I know you had at least one, if not more, publishers. I'm not going to say who's who, but that wanted to condense it down into one volume and kind of change the nature of what you've done.
We had multiple publisher offers. People were just interested in my words. People were just interested in the pictures. Had a lot of different offers and a lot of interest. Stephen went with our vision and said, you just do it the way you want to do it.
Yeah, fantastic. I think this is one of the only projects I've looked at that I haven't tinkered with.
You just said, this is lightning.
I will tell you, the more I've seen book one in its entirety and a huge chunk of book two. And I guess this is book two in front of me.
Right.
And I've got pieces
of
book three.
Yeah, you've actually got a disc
here
that he handed to you with some more stuff on it. Yeah.
The breadth of information here is mind-boggling.
It really is.
It's mind-boggling.
It's amazing. And just so people know, I'm gonna promote you here real quick with your store, Michael, up on JFK. Now, the Little Rock store may have this too, but if you go to Collector's Edition on JFK, you've got like original Tarzan books with the original
first
covers
edition,
for sale
second edition,
under the glass. Yeah, so if people are interested in this, go to the comic books or the Collector's Edition on JFK, and you've got some original edition Tarzan stuff for sale.
Right,
Do you also have that at the comic book store
in Treasure
Hill?
Yeah, we don't
have
the first editions in Treasure Hill like we do over at Little Rock. So we've got a nice big display case where we can put those in. We've got a lot of Robert E. Howard first editions in there, too.
Yeah.
But we do have a good selection of Burroughs at both locations. And while we're talking about the stores, I'd like to give a shout-out to Michelle, Jacob, and Kim. They've been working a lot of extra time, so I can get some more time off to work on the book there. So I wouldn't be able to complete it without all their help.
Yeah, I love your employees. I've gotten to know your employees over the years. Kimberly, the first day I went in there, she's ringing me
up. You got her.
And I said, aren't you going to ask me for my loyalty card? And she got real quiet. She goes, oh, I'm so sorry I didn't ask you for your loyalty card. And then she looked back at Michelle, who was training her. Michelle's like, he's messing with you. And then Kimberly started laughing and everything.
Yeah.
Well, that bit off air, I'll tell you how that kind of bit me in the rear the last time I went in a funny way, not in a bad way. But your employees are great. And I guess Jacob's about to be moving on. I'm going to miss him.
He's going to go to Chicago to pursue his career as an actor.
He's acting. He's been doing a lot of work at Murray's Dinner Theater and other things.
Done his own plays.
Yeah. I love Michelle and Kimberly and Jacob and everybody. So anyway, let's get a break in. When we come back, we're going to talk about why Edgar Rice Burroughs' work is important and why this project you're doing is important. Right here on Shane Plays Geek Talk Radio, 96.5 FM, The Answer.
Comic book lovers, visit thewildstars.com today. From the mind of author and comic book industry expert Michael Tierney, it's not just a comic book, it's a comic book novel. The Wild Stars is sci-fi and so much more. Learn the explanations behind UFOs and space gods. This isn't the Twilight Zone. This is the region of the Milky Way galaxy known as the Wild Stars. We guarantee you've never read anything like it. The complete comic book novel took 20 years to tell. With one reviewer noting, the story of the Wild Stars stretches ambitiously across space and time. From small town murders to the destruction of planets, with every event given multiple layers of meaning. If you haven't read The Wild Stars, you're missing out. Visit thewildstars.com today.
The die is cast.
Plunge into worlds of fantastic adventure, where dragons lie and the undead stalk the shades of your mind's imagines. Where creatures of legend plunder wealth through the horror of their passage. Monsters grim and foul hold the ecstasy of gold and the renown of glory. All this and more awaits you and your friends in the unlimited, fantastic world of the Castles and Crusades role-playing game from Trollord Games. Visit your friendly local game store or trollord.com to get your copy today. A rules-light, adaptable game that has stood the test of time. 12 years in constant publication with no new additions, Castles and Crusades is the original, easy-to-play attribute check system. Join us and unleash your imagination. Visit your friendly local game store or trollord.com to get your copy of Castles and Crusades today. Shane Plays Radio is blessed to have sponsors, and we appreciate them very much. However, did you know that you can also support the show as an individual for as little as $1 an episode? Simply go to patreon.com/ShanePlays.
Hey, welcome back to Shane Plays Geek Talk Radio right here on 96.5 FM The Answer and via podcast and Krypton Radio, kryptonradio.com is sci-fi for your Wi-Fi. We're talking today about Edgar Rice Burroughs. And if that name doesn't mean anything to you, think Tarzan and think Jon Carter of Mars. Because without Edgar Rice Burroughs, we wouldn't have Tarzan, we wouldn't have Jon Carter of Mars, which were massively influential on pop culture and entertainment and led to a lot of the movies, comic books, whatever that we have to today. I mean, we wouldn't have the comic books as we know it without the pulp era having come first.
Right. That's when science fiction was invented.
Right.
They called it pseudoscience back then.
Right. Well, I mean, Batman was originally basically just a pulp character that they put into the comic books, right?
Yeah.
I mean,
Batman was nothing but a copy of pulp character.
Right. Yeah. There you go. So
Superman, same thing.
Yeah. So, you know, it's very influential. Now, I would say the two, maybe three main names that I can think of off the top of my head. Oh, by the way, we're joined by Michael Tierney, who's an author and historian, and he's worked on this amazing four-volume set of Edgar Rice Burroughs' artwork, I guess, 100 years of Edgar Rice Burroughs' art chronology, and also friend of the show, Steve Chenault, normally representing Trollord Games and Castles and Crusades and Victorious and other games, but today representing Chenault and Gray Publishing, which is the parent company of Trollord Games. And they have come together like chocolate and peanut butter, and they're bringing us an amazing product in the form of this four-volume set that Michael, you've worked on for, I know, at least a couple of years. You've shown me. You're like, hey, come here, look at what every time I go in your comic
book store. It took me a lifetime to gather all the materials and 2 years to write it all up and put it into a good narrative and give you a lot of information. And then take all the images, restore them to new. Now, the ones I bought new myself, I mean, I'm the only hands who ever touched them. So I didn't even have to clean my scanner glass.
Right.
So I can just, you know, process those right on through.
But, I mean, there's literally hundreds, if not thousands, of restored artwork.
Oh, there's like about 5,000 pieces.
Yeah, comic book covers, novel covers.
Paperbacks.
Movie posters, maybe? Or there's
no
movie posters? Okay. But there's some really cool stuff in here. Mm-hmm. And, you know,
some of these pulp covers haven't been seen for like 100 years.
Yeah, everything I see looks amazing. And the artwork of that time was spectacular.
Oh, right? Yeah.
There's some really great artwork. So we're going to talk more about that project here in a second. But first, I want to talk about why, and I kind of teased it a little bit a moment ago, but why is Edgar Rice Burroughs so important? Why is Tarzan so important? Why is, and you know, I almost led the show today with the, but I was like, no, I want to treat it more serious than that, right? I mean, everyone thinks of Tarzan on the vine and all that stuff, but there's more to it than that. Like you said, we were talking before the show started. Steve, you brought up a good point that some of the people that do Tarzan art today make it kind of a little sexualized or a little voyeuristic. Right. But the reason that it was like that back in the day with like not a lot of clothes is they were trying to stress the removal of civilization.
Right.
Noble
right.
savage.
Right. The
if
noble
you look,
savage.
If you look
right.
at the period in which Tarzan was wrote, and it's the same time period that King Kong was written. And the world was changing rapidly.
The beginning of industrialization.
Right. Everything in people's lives was changing from automobiles to iceboxes, all of refrigerators, right. I guess, all of that stuff. Everything was changing very, very rapidly. So you had this kind of throwback to the primeval, noble savage, like Mike said. And Tarzan is representative of that. He's someone who's, he's different though in that he doesn't shed civilization like so many other Burroughs characters does. Tarzan is actually civilization born into the primeval
right,
world.
Right.
So he is the epitome of that noble savage, because he's what humanity should right. be. you know, because he's actually good, but he's extraordinarily brutal in his treatment of.
Well, it's the law of the jungle.
It's the law of the jungle.
Yeah, I mean,
that's not the right word, but with nobility bound mm-hmm. into it. So it's the,
right.
It's the best parts of both worlds.
Well, I mean, I want to take a step back and finish a thought I said earlier, but then I have another question for you. I would say that you got, for the main pulp names that I can think of course, you've got Edgar Rice Burroughs. You've got, I can't believe I'm forgetting the name, the guy that did Conan. Robert E. Howard with Conan and Solomon Kane. Who I've went back and reread the stuff. I like Conan, but I actually like the Solomon Kane stuff more than I did.
And that came before Conan.
Yeah, the Puritan who did not mess around.
Yeah.
And then I would argue that H.P. Lovecraft was a pretty big name in time and that, you know, kind of. But there's others. There's other names, but those are the three that I can think of that were
big. But Burroughs is really the only one. Howard does in our kind of hobby industry. But Burroughs, with the creation of Tarzan, he creates, because I guess Jon Carter came out first, right?
That was Jon Carter before.
Tarzan was his third novel.
Okay. Right, but Tarzan somehow transcends all of that.
Struck a nerve in culture. And like you said, it's an internationally recognized character. But wasn't there, you know, you're talking about the nobility. Am I right in remembering that he was Lord Greystoke and that he was a English nobility hard for
he's
us to understand now that right. English
he's very
Lord
popular
name.
In Britain now.
Yeah, because there used to be major class division in Victorian England. Uh-huh. And somehow the baby Lord Greystoke ended up in the jungle and is that the actual original origin that he was raised by the jungle and all that?
Okay. His parents were stranded by mutineers who just dumped him on the coast of Africa. And you know, his father built a cabin, and then his wife died shortly after the baby was born. And then the father was killed by one of the apes. And then Tarzan was taken in by one of the other apes and grew up to later take revenge, not knowing it, against his father's killer.
Okay. And like you said, Steve, these stories could be pretty brutal.
Yeah, they can be very brutal. And Tarzan's not the knight from Ivanhoe by any stretch. I can't remember which book it is, but I was reading one not long ago. It's one of the later books where Jane is kidnapped, or as always happens in almost all the books.
Right.
When he's rescuing her, he goes into this temple complex and he just kills a priest in his sleep. He kills the priest, takes his clothes.
Tarzan the Terrible.
And when you're reading it,
yep.
Tarzan doesn't hesitate to kill this priest. It's not, I'm going to wake him up and challenge him to a noble fight. I'm going to kill him.
Because I have a goal.
It was like that even in the comic books. One of the things I wrote is like, if you kidnap Jane, you know, better not get stand between
dead.
Tarzan, him on the way to rescue her, he's going to kill everything in between him and her. Yeah. Now, as the years went on, the Comics Code Authority came along. You know, he became more of a tree hugger, you know, don't harm anybody. But, I actually kept his battle scorecard of how many people and things he would kill in an issue. I mean, it was just incredible.
Well, you know, things have changed a lot. Like, the original Batman, I think in at least the first issue, had a gun. And either was going to kill somebody or didn't mind if they died. I mean, sensibilities have changed over the years.
Right.
Because now it's like Batman won't kill and Batman won't carry a gun, no matter. That's just it. You know, that's become codified. Uh-huh. But originally, like I said, he was much more pulp hero. You know, he's like, I've got to pull a gun on you. I'll pull a gun on you. I don't care. But, you know, what you're talking about, Steve, with the killing the priest in his sleep and all that, to me, that's the law of the jungle. In the jungle, if you get caught sleeping, you'll die.
Right.
You
know? And the priest is a bad guy. And if you read Burroughs' stuff, and especially Tarzan, it's that noble savage comes out. The good will win so long as they obey the law of the jungle.
Right.
Now, good may die along the way, but if you obey the law of the jungle and you're strong and powerful and decisive, and these are all of those things that Tarzan are, at the same time as holding on to that noble English heritage where you act the gentleman and you treat people decently and all this stuff. So it's a timeless story, and it's one of my biggest frustrations with the movie industry, because every Tarzan movie, I think,
they get wrong.
Well, they just go off of what is really actually. Now, the latter books are just fun reads.
Right.
But the first Tarzan book, Tarzan of the Apes, is a fantastic story.
So the very first one is called Tarzan of the Apes.
And one thing people forget is they were romance novels, really. I mean, action adventure with romantic settings.
Right.
The one of the more popular Tarzan movies ever made was Tarzan the Ape Man, which that one was built around Tarzan's romance with Jane, played by Marina Sullivan.
Now, how does Jane come into the mix in the stories? Where does she even come from?
Her and her father get stranded on the same coast that you know, Tarzan's parents were, and then so they start living in his cabin, and Tarzan's obviously checking out. Like, yeah. Hey, who's this?
He's like, who is this?
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
See, and that's where that iconic scene comes from, where the ape kidnaps Jane, takes her into the jungle, and he chases her, pursues her, and then he fights that ape.
Burroughs left that first volume with a cliffhanger.
Oh, yeah.
Because his cousin has taken over his estate, and he's in love with Jane. And so, you know, Tarzan thinks, well, I'll just do the noble thing. They figure out, hey, your fingerprints have identified you as Lord Greystoke. And so he's reading this newsletter, and people are asking him, well, you know, what's there? And he goes, oh, I don't know. My mother was an ape, never knew who my father was. And he just walks away to let her marry his cousin. Mm. Well, people had to have more.
Yeah, they're not.
But it is in Wisconsin, doesn't it? It's like somewhere. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, Wisconsin.
The last part of the book is...
The Wisconsin is a primal jungle, obviously. Well,
we got her back to civilization.
So here's some tropes of Tarzan. Obviously, the swinging through the jungle while going, oh, right? He had a... was it a monkey named Cheetah?
Only in the movies.
Came from the movies? Like, was swinging on vines, was that from the books, or did the movies do that?
No, he did it in the books. I mean, Burroughs described the jungle as having, like, three terraces. So Tarzan was usually running around through the middle terraces.
Right.
That was kind of his highway through the jungle.
Okay. So that, but the ululating, that's a movie, TV thing?
Well, actually, no, he did have this, what they call the bull ape call, you know, a victory cry whenever he would kill something, and... So that was from the book. His victory cry, the bull ape.
But not necessarily the sort of George of the Jungle.
Yeah, you know, when I read those as a kid, I never saw Tarzan really. He does swing, definitely, but he's mostly leaping from branch to branch.
Okay.
And that bull ape cry, I never in my head imagined it as the thing that Johnny Weissmuller, is that who?
Is that who came up with that?
That's who came up with
the movies?
That. Right. I always just pictured it as, if you listen to like any kind of animal in the wild call, it's primeval. It's brutal.
And it's
not
to be
some
very
kind.
Scary sound. Yeah,
yeah,
that
it's
sounds
not
like he actually
hit
a branch in the wrong area. Anyway,
it's a Rocola commercial.
So you had Jane, So you had Jane. You had Cheetah was from the movies. Cheetah the monkey.
Now Tarzan did have a monkey in a lot of the books called Nakima.
Okay, all right. So very primal, very pulp, and of course pulp. Comes from the actual material that those books were printed on, right?
Like pulp paper,
right? I wonder if Edgar Rice Burroughs had any idea. Was he just writing his stuff for a buck, or did he really have? Was he trying to create something here? Have you found that?
What happened was, he was reading a lot of those. And, you know, Edgar Rice Burroughs was failed everything he ever tried to do. I mean, he'd been everything from a policeman, a railroad cop. He'd been. A gold miner. I mean, he had tried it all. He'd been a stationary salesman.
A lot of people who have success in this kind of way are like that. They're just wandering, trying
to find.
My
understanding is he did some self-help things, and then he ran ads for that in the pulps, and that's where he got introduced to the pulps. Is that true?
I don't know about the ads, but I know he was reading some of the pulps. He's like, well, I can write better stories than this. Because he always was a storyteller. So he writes down, part of a Princess of Mars, and which was called Under the Moons of Mars at the time, and he sends it in, but he wrote under a pseudonym of Normal Bean. Like, everything's okay with my head. I'm not really crazy.
Yeah, I'm okay, even though I'm writing this, my
and then when
normal.
They accepted it, had him finish it, and then when they published it, they typoed it, and they made him Norman Bean. Lost the whole joke.
Yeah.
So, with his later novel, Tarzan of the Apes, Edgar Rice Burroughs, and then they put in parentheses, Norman Bean.
Norman Bean.
And he got away from that whole Norman Bean thing, because they completely blew it.
They blew the joke. So, in your research or where did he come up with the idea for Tarzan? Do you know? Has he ever shared that?
No, he doesn't actually. There was no aha moment that he says, this is where I came up with that character. He had written A Princess of Mars, then he wrote another novel called Outlaw and Torn, which the editors kept having rewrite it, a historical piece. Finally, then he went past that and went ahead and wrote Tarzan of the Apes, and they accepted the first draft of that one.
Boom. It was.
I did a little reading up before. We launched the Kickstarter, so I could get a little information kind of tucked away on. I've always been a huge Burroughs fan, but I never read much about the man himself.
Right.
I'd learned bits and pieces, but at the time that he wrote Tarzan, there was a lot of scholastic articles and just journal articles on people who were raised in the wild.
Yeah, there was a.
So that was kind of this undercurrent, and then there was the Jungle Book, is that
Rudyard Kipling?
Mowgli.
Kind of floating around out there.
Yeah, it came out shortly before that, which he says he's never read that.
Yeah, and
of course, if you go back, Romulus and Remus, I mean, this is a concept that's been around a long time.
I think I would believe Burroughs in that, because the Jungle Book and Tarzan have really
Nothing.
Yeah.
I mean, the completely different.
Yeah, there's yeah, not. Just, yeah.
They just both bought into a theme that was kind of common in the day of people being raised in the wild.
Well, there's actually my main degree is actually in psychology, and we studied the concept of the wild child, because psychologists for a long time, they really wanted to find real wild childs because of the nature versus nurture debate. We want to find people who weren't raised in civilization to see, you know, how much impact that had on their morality and this and that and the other. Right. But anyway, so Tarzan, major, major international, completely understood. If you see Tarzan artwork, most people know that's Tarzan, right? And speaking of artwork, your books are filled with, you can just look, obviously we want people to read the books too, the people who really want to know the backstory on everything, but man, you could just look through these page after page after page of all this restored, colorful, amazing artwork.
Yeah, you get the history of the artist, the history of the story, Edgar Rice Burroughs' history. We were talking about Rudyard Kipling. One little interesting tidbit in there is an editor had quit at one of the publications, All Story, which later became Argosy, and he was replaced by another editor who was the cousin of Rudyard Kipling. And he immediately told Burroughs, we don't need no more of your work. You're done here.
Yeah, there's just weird.
Then the editors changed. Hey, come on back.
Come on back. Yeah.
When they notice their sales declining.
That guy did. Yeah. Well, then the guy goes to another magazine called Liberty, and he has a hard time getting any story sold there. He finally had to hire an agent to get a story sold at Liberty. So sometimes, you know, people have a bias, and I don't know if that goes back to the whole Jungle Book thing, competition,
or what,
since he was related.
Well, I'm telling you, people, one thing we haven't mentioned a lot, but one of the reasons we're talking today, there's a Kickstarter going on that made 70-80% of its goal on first day. It's only been out for a few days. It's been picked as a project we love by Kickstarter. The link is on shaneplays.com in the show notes, but just search Kickstarter for Edgar Rice Burroughs. You'll find it, or search Edgar Rice Burroughs 100-year art chronology.
You can actually type in the word Edgar
and it'll pop up.
It pops up.
Yeah. So you've got 32 days to go. Your initial goal is $39,900. Right now you're setting at $30,833. Yeah. And, this is obviously, and like I said before the show, unless an asteroid comes out and blows up the planet, this is going to
fund it.
Congratulations. Yeah, there's a need and a desire for this.
I was blown away by the first day of support. Yeah. I mean, it's actually our biggest opening Kickstarter today.
Well, yeah, I heard some cool stretch goals you were talking. I'm not going to share them because it's not my business.
We got to iron that out.
But you've got stretch goals that you're talking about. So this is going to be a great, great, great Kickstarter project, 4 volumes. We'll talk about that more after the break. Want to get a break in. We'll talk about the Kickstarter, but I also want to talk a little bit about Jon Carter of Mars.
Okay.
Because it's not quite as well known as Tarzan, but it has a passionate fan base for
everybody who's read both Tarzan and Jon Carter. Well, not everybody, but usually people prefer Jon Carter actually over Tarzan. Right.
I've got a friend who's big on Jon Carter.
Yeah. So
it's like me when I went back and read Robert E. Howard, and there's really only a few Conan stories.
Yeah, 20 and something.
Yeah,
something
like that. And I read all the Conan stories, and then I read Solomon Kane, and Solomon Kane was bigger to me than Conan was, even though I love the Conan movie, the original, in the comic books and all. But anyway, I got to get a break in. We're going to throw some love at a show sponsor, get a break in. We'll come back, talk about Jon Carter, and then we will talk a little bit more about the Kickstarter. And unfortunately, we have to wrap the show because in radio, time is a predator that stalks us all our lives. Now, this is a serious ad because it's on paper, right? You think? Okay. So some goblins are your friends. Game Goblins is Central Arkansas's premier retailer of Magic the Gathering, Warhammer 40K, board games, card games, RPGs, and they got Castles of Crusades over there. I'm just saying.
Yes,
they do. Y'all have Victorious over there, too?
I'm not sure we got that over there.
I know you got Castles. Yeah. I know you got a good selection of Castles of Crusades over there. RPGs, miniatures, hobby accessories. Call Game Goblins at 501-224-GAME or visit them online at gamegoblins.com. That's 501-224-GAME or gamegoblins.com. Folks, I want to remind everybody that on June 17th, from 10 in the morning till midnight, we're having a free RPG day event all day long at Game Goblins. Of course, you're going to have the free RPG day swag, of which Trollord Games is going to have a product in that. We're going to have games all day long, free games. Jump on in all the way up till midnight. And there's going to be giveaways, I think, either every 30 minutes or every hour. And there's going to be a used RPG sell and swap. So bring your books, do some selling, do some swapping. It's going to be a great day, June 17th at Game Goblins. For all your gaming needs, I heartily recommend Game Goblins. Make sure to check out their customer loyalty program that rewards you based on your actual purchases. Game Goblins earns your business and keeps it. First-time customers mention Shane Plays and receive $10 off your purchase of $50 or more. That's Game Goblins over there on 1121 South Bowman, right on the corner of Bowman and Canis in West Little Rock. Tell them Shane Plays sent you.
Comic book lovers, visit thewildstars.com today. From the mind of author and comic book industry expert Michael Tierney, it's not just a comic book, it's a comic book novel. The Wild Stars is sci-fi and so much more. Learn the explanations behind UFOs and space gods. This isn't the Twilight Zone. This is the region of the Milky Way galaxy known as the Wild Stars. We guarantee you've never read anything like it. The complete comic book novel took 20 years to tell, with one reviewer noting, "The story of the Wild Stars stretches ambitiously across space and time, from small town murders to the destruction of planets, with every event given multiple layers of meaning." If you haven't read The Wild Stars, you're missing out. Visit thewildstars.com today.
The die is cast.
Plunge into worlds of fantastic adventure where dragons lie and the undead stalk the shades of your mind's imagines. Where creatures of legend plunder wealth through the horror of their passage. Monsters grim and foul hold the ecstasy of gold and the renown of glory. All this and more awaits you and your friends in the unlimited, fantastic world of the Castles and Crusades role-playing game from Trollord Games. Visit your friendly local game store or trollord.com to get your copy today. A rules-light, adaptable game that has stood the test of time. 12 years in constant publication with no new additions, Castles and Crusades is the original easy-to-play attribute check system. Join us and unleash your imagination. Visit your friendly local game store or trollord.com to get your copy of Castles and Crusades today. Shane Plays Radio is blessed to have sponsors, and we appreciate them very much. However, did you know that you can also support the show as an individual for as little as $1 an episode? Simply go to patreon.com/ShanePlays.
Hey, welcome back to Shane Plays Geek Talk Radio, a journey into the things we love. This is live talk radio. It goes out as a podcast later, but it's live talk radio. If anyone wants to call in, you can call in at 501-823-0965. You can talk to Michael Tierney, who is a author and a historian. We're talking about his 4-volume Art of Edgar Rice Burroughs project that is on Kickstarter right now and doing gangbusters. But Michael also writes and self-publishes The Wild Stars, which is like 20-something year history. How long has it been going, Michael?
Oh, I've been publishing it 30 years, over yeah. 30 years, yeah.
And it's a crazy X-Files meets alien space gods. I can't remember how we wrote that up.
Yeah, yeah. I had an artist who used to draw for me, and he described it as, you know, like Dallas meets Star Wars.
That was it, yeah. It's just this crazy big epic thing.
But at the same time, it was all down to earth, back yeah. with woods, dirty dealing, all, you know, a big variety of stories.
Right, so, and also... we've got Steve Chenault, normally comes on the show under the auspices of Trollord Games, but he's actually here today as a representative of Chenault and Gray Publishing, which is the parent company of Trollord Games. And he's working with Michael Tierney here and to publish this really cool Edgar Rice Burroughs project. So I want to, before the end of the show, I want to talk a little bit more about the Kickstarter. But we got, you know, we've talked mainly about Tarzan. If somebody's never heard of Jon Carter of Mars, what's Jon Carter of Mars?
Jon Carter of Mars is a fellow who actually teleports to another planet.
From the Civil War era, right?
Yeah, it's okay. Right after the Civil War, he was gold prospecting and was attacked by a bunch of Indians who killed a friend of his, goes into a cave, and next thing you know, he comes out of the cave and zaps to Mars.
And then he has adventures with a princess and... Right. What is the Barsoom part of it? What is Barsoom?
Well, Barsoom is what the natives of Mars call their home world.
But it's very... pulpy, swords, a little bit of science fiction, action.
15-foot forearmed green men.
Yeah. Yeah. And they did a movie a few years back that was somewhat...
yeah, that was supposed to have been the definitive movie on Jon Carter, but a little bit of art direction you kind of lost. It did not look like it was on another planet. When you watch Avatar, this is another planet.
Yeah.
This one looked more like it was Aliens versus Cowboys Part 2. I mean, it looked like it was set in the Arizona desert. So it didn't have that otherworldly feel. Plus, too, it's like, and the, you know, a very lovely actress who played, you know, Deja Thoris, the Princess of Mars. But she, you know, they took the direction of, they had her more tatted up than a sailor who just got out of federal prison.
Right.
I mean, you know, just, it just wasn't the right look for her.
Right. And, they were being hip. They were being hip.
Yep. It just did all click.
Well, it seems to me now like Tarzan has been, is definitely in the public conscience and pop culture knowledge deeper than Jon Carter. But it seems to me that this being on a different planet, being with a princess, fighting, that seems to me to have spawned more imitators.
Oh, yeah.
In pulp and comic books and all that than Tarzan has.
Oh, yeah. He's been imitated since the days of the pulps. I mean, people were writing like him way back then.
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, even you could almost say that Adam Strange from the comics is almost a Jon Carter because he teleports to Ran and he's got, he's the princess and all that. But there's more of that primal, brutal, scantily clad kind of, I'm on Mars, whatever.
Yeah.
And I want to point out again for people maybe who are just joining, you know, today, like people are doing Jon Carter or they're doing Tarzan and it's scantily clad to be titillating. Right. To be
right.
For voyeurism. But back then it was just to represent the move away from civilization, the more primal nature of the stories. Right. So,
yeah, Jon Carter, actually, because when he shows up on Mars, he's naked, of course. As I think all of Burroughs' characters are naked at some point.
For some strange reason. Okay. Some reason primal. It's primal.
But it really is that kind of. And Mars, of course, is an ancient civilization that's dying.
Right.
So you have this whole kind of thematic development of the character in the world that starts fresh. It starts with him, an earthling with his own, you know, earthling biases or whatever, coming to Mars and rebuilding himself into something that is more than he was because he's entered into this declining civilization. And he kind of, in many ways, upholds the civilization, kind of brings it back to its noble origins.
He's the outsider who still brings it.
The first huge chunk of that book is just kind of the society of the green men, the Tharks. And the red men too. I mean, so it's a whole bunch of pseudoscience. Is that what you called it earlier?
Well, that's what they used to call it before science fiction was termed.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's fascinating stuff. And you know, the three books I read over and over again: Tolkien's Silmarillion, Princess of Mars, and Tarzan of the Apes.
Wow,
I those are the ones my go-to.
So this was like this project was tailor made for you.
It was tailor made for me. You can literally, and I'm going to do it in a video here in the next day or so. I've got this jacket from when I was like 6 years old that I took the Tarzan and the monkey, I think, and I think there's a lion, and ironed on that jacket, and I wore that jacket forever in the 70s. So,
I love it. All right, guys, we got 3 minutes. I want to remind people, this is Edgar Rice Burroughs is important in and of his own, just for the pulp and the characters you created, but the art associated with the pulps, the novels, the paperbacks, the comic books is amazing in its own right.
I want to throw out real quick, when Mike pitched this, it was three books, and we talked about it quite a bit, and the comic section was broken into four books because there's so much content. I mean, there's so much content here, and the art and the pictures, it's unbelievable. And then it's accompanied by some very well-written prose text that follows us on a nice historical journey that includes mountains of trivia from the pulp era that's about the pulps, too, not
just
about
Burroughs.
And
see, I love that stuff. I love the trivia.
See, I do, too. Right. And especially when he stays on topic, but he discusses the history of Argosy, right? I mean, it's...
Oh, yeah, the history of the pulps, the history of the manufacturing of the pulps.
Yeah, and I mean, that's what I'm saying. So much important stuff to pop culture and, you know, these characters is all coming together. I think this is going to be a very important...
Scholastic
this is, I mean, you guys, you know, the Kickstarter's going boom. You guys have struck a nerve here. It's, you got lightning in a bottle, all that stuff. Michael, I'm personally just tickled pink for you as a friend that this is finally happening because you've been working on it for so long and you've been showing me all the hard work you've been doing and everything. I'm glad that two people that are friends of mine are coming together to make this happen. This is exciting for me all around.
For me, I'm still as a huge Burroughs fan, much more than anyone else, even Green Lantern. I'm in awe of what you've done, Mike, because this stuff is amazing.
And if people need to go to the Kickstarter, search for Edgar or Edgar Rice Burroughs or whatever on Kickstarter, you go to the Shane Place show notes page and find this 100-year art chronology. It's a 4-volume set. And just the artwork on the Kickstarter page, if that doesn't get you excited, there's something wrong with you. Why are you listening to this show is what I'm saying.
Oh, they also get more of a taste if they go to my website, www.thewildstars.com. And on there, I've got some pages where, you know, I was kind of doing a little bit of prep work on this, on Tarzan, on Jon Carter. And also have a page on the Edgar Rice Burroughs 100-year art chronology also. And with the link on also how to, you know, get to the Kickstarter, a little shortcut there.
Okay.
So you can see a lot, a taste of a lot of the art.
We'll get that all linked from the Kickstarter.
Yeah,
we'll
make this sure stuff that's all is on cool. Guys, I do the bad joke of the week now. In honor of this, I've got two bad jokes of the week.
I just want to tell you real quick that Gary Gygax, when I worked with him, he loved to tell me puns because I never got them. I never got his jokes or puns. So go.
All right. Well, I love this. Is okay. So in honor, I have two bad jokes. Why didn't Tarzan answer Jane's call?
I don't know.
His mind was busy.
So, okay. All right.
Why didn't Tarzan like to play poker in the jungle?
You got me.
There were too many cheetahs. All right. Going on that. Guys, congratulations. Mike, this Kickstarter is going to hit.
Oh, well,
congratulations to both of you. We'll catch folks next time on Shane Plays Geek Talk Radio. Oh, yeah, definitely.
You missed, Mr. Bond. Did I? I'm now aiming precisely at your groin. It says speak or forever hold your peace.
He suggests the trade. The egg for your life.
Well, I'd heard the price of eggs was going up, but isn't that a little high? Did have an inflated opinion of himself.
Put me down! Put me down!
Oh, you want to get up?
Mr. Bond!
For your eyes on me, the night's on.
Shane Plays Radio is blessed to have sponsors, and we appreciate them very much. However, did you know that you can also support the show as an individual for as little as $1 an episode? Simply go to patreon.com/ShanePlays.